be able to bring the word this morning. And I do just thank you for all your prayers for me throughout the year. I know that God used them to sustain me and just allow me to keep going when seminary was difficult or when life had difficult circumstances. This morning, we will be in the book of 1 John, specifically chapter 2, verses 12 through 17. 1 John, if you're unfamiliar with the Bible, it is after 2 Peter and before 2 John. So if you're in 2 John, 1 John is before that. If you're looking for where John is, go and find Peter, and then you'll find John. Before we get into the word this morning, I want to ask a question, or rather pose a quote, and I want you guys to reflect on it. All of you have been children at some point. All of you are still young, but all of you have been children at some point. And so the quote I want to mention is one that I'm sure you heard growing up. It is, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words may never hurt me." I know that some of you didn't grow up in the U.S., so I don't know if there's a Chinese equivalent. I'm sure there is. But essentially, this means that, you know, when you were in elementary school recess, people are making fun of you. You say that as a defense of saying, you know, it doesn't matter what you say to me because you're not actually hurting me with your fist. You're not actually hitting me or anything. And so your words really don't have any effect on me. But the truth of the matter is that's completely false. I believe words can be uplifting and they can be just as damaging. I specifically remember an incident in third grade. So I guess I'm 27 now. Third grade was a long time ago. And in third grade, you know, I guess in elementary school, you have to take all these different subjects because they want to, you know, get you to experience a lot of different things. And I remember being in art. And so I was in art, and we were doing these drawings with, like, permanent marker. I didn't really understand it. But you know what they say about art. Art is art. It's whatever. Art, anything can be art. But I remember my teacher was like, "What is this?" And she started to yell at me and, like, correct me. And I remember I was crying. And pretty much after that day, I swore off art, which is why still today, many, 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 many years later, I don't understand art. I go to a museum and I see art and I have no idea what's going on. And so words can be powerful. And so the reason I bring this up is John wants to encourage his readers of their position in Christ. He wants them to be moved to worship of Christ and as a result respond by living obediently to what he is encouraging them to live and how God has called them to live. And so, read now with me God's word. Again, we're in 1 John chapter 2, verses 12 through 17. This is the word of God. "I am writing to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. I am writing to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I am writing to you, young men, because you have overcome the evil one. I write to you, children, because you know the Father. I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the evil one. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whomever does the will of God abides forever." Pray with me. Father God, we thank you that you have gathered us this morning to worship together as one body. Though we are many members and many individuals, we're ultimately united as one body because of what your Son, Jesus Christ, has done for us. As we come to your word this morning, we ask that you would soften our hearts, that you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear, and that we would truly be reminded of who we are in Christ and what you have called us to. Would you fill us with your Spirit? Would you allow us to focus as you communicate to us and as you exhort us with the good news of your word? Thank you for everything that you've done for us. Thank you that you have chosen to save us out of your grace. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name, amen. Before we unpack the context of John's message, it is important to understand that we need to understand what is going on here. So, you know, you could just pick up the Bible, flip anywhere, and start reading, and perhaps you can glean truths from that. But it's really important to understand that the context of what is going on affects how we understand the content of what is going on. And so, You know, as good Presbyterians, we often read the Bible like it's written like a systematic theology. We have all these verses memorized, and we say, hey, no, this is where I go to prove this point, this is where I go to defend that point, this is where I go to share the gospel. While those things are true, ultimately we need to understand that there's context behind messages. The book of 1 John was not just written to believers in general. It was written to believers in the churches of Asia Minor because they were struggling to deal with false teachers and because that some of their so-called believers had just recently left the church. And so he's addressing a very specific issue. And so we need to understand that. Furthermore, there's often tricky things in the Bible that we don't understand or seem to contradict. If you take a moment and look at verse 15, it says, do not love the world or the things in the world. You know, again, if you don't understand what's going on here, you know, is God just saying, is John writing to these believers and saying, you know, don't love the world, don't love anyone, hate everything? Well, you know, that would be contradictory to, you know, the very well-known verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And so again, these things seem to contradict. So how do we reconcile what is going on here? Well, again, it's important to understand when we see world here, words have different meanings. And so here, specifically, world means anything that is diametrically opposed to God or any allegiance that is away from God. If you flip to Ephesians 2 with me, you can see this played out in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 2. Paul writes there, he says, and you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. So again, that's what world means here. He's not saying just hate everyone, just, you know, hate non-Christians. No, he's saying don't live in the same way as they live. And so there's so much going on here. Specifically this morning, we're just going to cover verses 12 through 14. And the next time around, we're going to cover 15 through 17 because there's a lot of rich material here that I want us to get into and understand. The focus of the message is going to be that we are forgiven in Christ, we are fortified in Christ, and we are freed in Christ. So it's in Christ all of these things happen. Apart from Christ, none of these things happen. So as we jump into the text, one more thing that I want to point out is if you look at verses 12 through 14, he's addressing three different audiences. In verse 12 and the end of verse 13, he says little children and children. In verse 13 and 14, he says fathers. And then in verse 13 and 14, he says young men. So, you know, who is he specifically talking to here? Well, he uses children or little children as a sign of affection, as a sign of love to them. Throughout the letter, he uses this. If you go look at verse 1 of chapter 2, he says, my little children, I am writing these things to you. And so we have to understand that he's addressing all believers here, the whole congregation that is gathered. He wants them to understand these messages. But more specifically, as he addresses fathers, he's addressing those who are spiritually mature or have been in the faith for a long time. And then when he's addressing young men, he's addressing those who perhaps are newer believers or those who are immature in the faith. This is not a gender thing. He's not only talking to men. He's talking about their maturity in faith, and he uses these titles to address them. And so let us unpack together what this all means together, starting with what does it mean that we are forgiven in Christ? Look, read now God's word with me. He says, I am writing to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. Our sins are forgiven in Christ's name and for Christ's sake. You know, we can see this throughout the rest of the letter. If you go back to 1 John chapter 1, verses 7 through 9, he says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So fundamentally, as Christians, we need to understand that our sins are forgiven in Christ and in Christ alone. So, and what, you know, what did Christ do for us? Not only did Christ come in the form of man, fully God and fully human, live the perfect life, and die, but he was raised from the dead, which shows that he has victory over sin and death. And that is how we know it is truly finished. He said on the cross himself, it is finished. And we know that it is finished because he rose again from the dead. And so fundamentally, John wants this congregation to understand that they're forgiven, because this is the fundamental truth of the Christian faith. Without the forgiveness of sins, there is no hope. So with these false teachers teaching all these different things, he wants to make sure that they've not deviated from the truth that they have heard from him before. Furthermore, he writes in the end of verse 13, he says, "I write to you, children, because you know the Father." Well, how is that connected to the forgiveness of sins? You know, it seems like he's just kind of talking about, okay, your sins are forgiven, and now you know the Father. You know, there seemingly isn't a relationship. But again, John explains it himself. If you go to the beginning of chapter 2, he says, "My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." So Jesus is our advocate. He pleads our case on our behalf so that we are forgiven. It isn't as if we come to Jesus and that's the pathway to forgiveness, and then the rest of the Christian life, it's just on our own merits. It's not on our own efforts. No, it's because Jesus is interceding for us that we are forgiven. And it's through Jesus that we ultimately have access to the Father. This thing is done. It is finished. It is complete. And so, to illustrate what this looks like, I want to just share an example that happened to my life about, I think, 2 years ago or so. I work with CREW, Campus Crusade for Christ, as a campus minister, but for 2 years, I helped out at this conference where people were getting ready to go overseas, and specifically, people were going to China. And as you know, China is a closed country, so we have to secure their computers. And so because I'm kind of self-taught with computers, and I'm a nerd, and I like Google, and I can look up problems to solve, I went and volunteered and helped out. And so the first year I went, it was really well. It went really good, and I was really confident. And so when they asked me back the next year, I went again. And so we're pretty much in this room for 12 to 14 hours a day just working on computers. Just, you know, they're stacked on top of each other because there's probably 200, 300 people going to China, and we have 5 days to get all the computers secured. And thankfully, we have a script. We have things that do a lot of stuff. There are still things we need to do manually. And so one night, the last night I was there, I was working on this computer, and it was probably 2 a.m. or so. You know, it's late. I don't recommend you stay up 2 a.m. too often. But I'm working on this computer, and it's been on this update screen for probably 2 hours. 3 a.m., it still says installing Windows updates, 100%, you know, it says 100% done. But, you know, the little thing is still turning. 3 a.m., same thing. 4 a.m., same thing. And I'm like, I got to go to sleep. I'm tired. And so you should not do this, but I went ahead and turned off the computer. I was like, it said 100%. It should be done. It's definitely done. And then when I turned on the computer again, it had crashed. And I was like, oh, great. I have no idea what's going on. This guy's probably leaving in 10 hours. I messed up this computer. And so I just wrote a note. I felt bad, but I was like, I need to go to sleep. I have no idea what's going on. So I wrote a note and said, you know, this computer's messed up. Please come and fix this. By the grace of God, my teammates were able to bail me out and help me out. And I think that really illustrates to me that 100% on computers isn't always 100%. When it says something is done, it doesn't mean it's always done. Maybe you're downloading something off Google Chrome and it's done, but the wheels keep turning. It's not done. And if you cancel it, you're going to lose it and have to re-download it. But the thing is, our forgiveness is truly complete. It is forgiven. When Christ says it is finished, it is finished. When he says your sins are forgiven, your sins are forgiven. And so we really need to understand that, because fundamentally, apart from that, we have no hope. And so what does that look like for you as a believer? Maybe you've been coming to church even as a baby. You know, your parents took you to the church. Maybe you're a new believer. Maybe you've just been coming for a few years. I think primarily the thing you need to ask yourself is, why are you forgiven? Why are you forgiven? Think about a time recently where you maybe fell into sin. Maybe it's something that you've struggled with for 5, 10, 15 years. Maybe it's lying. Maybe it's cheating. Maybe it's deceiving others. Maybe it's being short with your parents. Maybe it's being short with your kids. Whatever it is, we're often convicted of our sin afterwards. But there's also times we're condemned in our sin. because of Satan and his lies and his temptation and telling us to despair. So the way that we fight back is to take time and to think, why am I forgiven? Are you forgiven because your kids are perfect and obey you all the time? Are you forgiven because you drive a nice car and live in a big house? Are you forgiven because your mortgage has been paid off? Are you forgiven because you got into the college of your choice and you are summa cum laude and are graduating with honors? Are you forgiven because you had a quiet time every day? Are you forgiven because you come to Sunday school? Are you forgiven because you share the gospel with your friends? A lot of those are good things, but ultimately none of them can save you, and none of them forgive you. Only what Christ has done allows you to find forgiveness. And it is in those moments where you can say, I'm a great sinner, but I have a great Savior. And that is why my sin is forgiven. And so now that we understand that foundation, that we are forgiven in Christ, it is important for us to understand how we are fortified in Christ, how we grow in Christ. Take a look with me at verse 13. He says to the fathers, I'm writing to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. And then verse 14, he says, I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. You know, what's going on here? Did he accidentally write the same thing twice? You know, sometimes you're shooting an email and you type the exact same word twice in a row. You're typing a paper. You start thinking about something else and just randomly type stuff. No, he's not. This isn't an accident. This is intentional. He wants them to understand, the fathers, those who are more spiritually mature, that what they know is true. Again, contextually, we talked about how there were some false believers among them, false teachers among them, who were teaching that ultimately Jesus did not come in the flesh. Jesus only appeared to come in the flesh, and that the forgiveness of sins was found in other methods. If you go down with me a little bit to, in chapter 2, go to verse 19. He says, they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain that they all are not of us. But you have been anointed by the Holy One, and you all have knowledge. I write to you not because you do not know the truth, but because you know it, and because no lie is of the truth. So he's telling them, what you guys have is good. Even though there were these false believers, what you guys have is good. You know the truth. You've acquired it. And we even see this, you know, if you go to the beginning of 1 John, it might seem like a strange opening. He says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life, and so on and so forth. So he says this, you know, that's kind of a strange beginning. He's writing a letter, but he doesn't open as he does in a lot of the other letters by saying that he's thankful for them, that he loves them, that he knows them. He just seemingly randomly opens up. But again, it's that language we see from the beginning. He wants them to know that they do know Christ, that their faith is secure, even though some have left the faith, some have proclaimed Christ and lived in a different manner. And so that's what they needed to hear in that instance. You know, a lot of times we might think, oh, well, we just need to go to the upper rungs of theology, and when someone's having a problem, someone's having difficulty, that's what we hammer home. No, we hammer home the truths of the gospel, and we hammer home the fact that they do know the truth. And so how does that play out for us today? Well, I was doing some research on how do we figure out what counterfeit money looks like. I actually went on YouTube, saw the video. There was a person from the Secret Service there, so I can corroborate and say that it's true. It wasn't just some random YouTube channel. It was by this like PBS channel. I can send you the link if you're interested for whatever reason. And so, you know, they're saying, hey, this is what a genuine $100 bill looks like. And they say, you know, you hold it up to the light and you're gonna see this little, you know, picture of Ben Franklin go back and forth. You're gonna see this little color strip, this ribbon. If you touch to the right of the portrait on there, you also feel different texture. And so they go through all these different methods and saying, this is how you know what a real dollar bill is. Because there's hundreds, thousands of counterfeits out there. Some probably aren't as good as others, but some are really, really, really good. And so you only have so much time to train people. So if you spent hundreds of hours, you know, saying these are all the false ones, a new one comes out, you're not going to be able to identify it. And so, in the same sense, as Christians, in order for us to be fortified in our faith, we need to learn more about our faith, we need to grow in our faith, and we need to know what it is that we believe. We need to know the Bible. We need to know that. There are other groups, like Jehovah's Witnesses, who claim to use the same Bible. There's groups as Mormons. They use, you know, they seemingly use the same Bible. Muslims say the Bible is one of their spiritual books. Ultimately, in the Quran is the full revelation. But they would, you know, if we don't know what we're talking about, they would say, oh yeah, you know, we believe the exact same thing. And it's really easy to be deceived unless you know what it is that you believe. And so for some of you, that is sharing the knowledge that you have with others. If you know a lot about theology, if you know a lot about the Bible and know what it means to walk with Christ, you have a responsibility. Again, he's writing to fathers, those who are spiritually mature. You have a responsibility to help those who are less spiritually mature and newer in their faith. You can't just look at them disdainfully and say, well, they don't know as much as I do, someone else will help them. No, as a body of Christ, you have a responsibility to one another. And furthermore, it's important. Again, there's hundreds and thousands of false religions out there, but it's important to understand some variations within Christianity, seemingly in Christianity. You talk to a Mormon, he's gonna say that he's Christian. You talk to a Jehovah's Witness, he's gonna say he's Christian. You need to know what you believe, and when they say something, be able to identify, that's incorrect because you said this, because you said that. And the truth of the matter, the reality of this, is that it can happen to anyone. There was a friend I ministered with for a few years, and he had just moved back to the States, and he and his wife and his kids were looking for a church, and they found a church, and he was really, really, really excited about it. And again, being the nerd that I am, I was like, oh, what's the name of your church? And so I'm on the phone with him, I'm looking up the church, talking with him, and just something about the church didn't sit right with me. And as I did more and more and more research, I discovered that they were part of the International Church of Christ. And the International Church of Christ espouses that you must have water baptism in order to be saved. If you do not have water baptism and you proclaim Christ, you are still not saved. And so I felt really bad because this guy was really excited about this church. He said, you know, we're going to go. We're plugged into a small group. I told him, I was like, I don't think they're Christian. And so, you know, he was really bummed, and we talked a little more about it, and he called up the small group leader and said, you know, I don't think we can go to your church anymore. But this is a guy who was in ministry for 5 years, and he was caught off guard. It can happen to anyone. And so it's important for Christians to be discerning. Again, it doesn't mean that we challenge everything that we hear. It doesn't mean that we are skeptical in everything, but we need to be willing to say, okay, this is what they say they believe. I need to push them on what they believe. I need to go to their website and see what it is they believe. I need to talk to the pastor. I need to talk to the members so that we will not be deceived. And that's ultimately how we can be fortified in Christ. That's how we can move forward in our faith. If we don't know the fundamentals of Christianity, again, addressing the children, everyone, if we don't know the fundamentals of Christianity, we can't grow up. But then as we grow, we need to learn more and more about the Bible. We need to learn how people misuse passages. We need to learn how they try to deceive us, whether that's them teaching that forgiveness of sins ultimately comes through praying a prayer 10 times or through, you know, going to church half an hour early. Whatever it is, there is plenty of deception out there, and we need to be willing to engage and identify with it. You know, at this point, some of you might be wondering, that's exactly why I don't believe in Christianity, because there are so many variations in Christianity. There's hundreds of denominations. There's hundreds of groups. You know, how can you guys say that you are united when there's so many divisions? And I think it's a very fair point. The church has not done a good job of being united. Yes, we hold our theological beliefs, but sometimes we hold them too tightly on certain issues that we don't even fellowship with people who disagree on a minor issue. But I would encourage you, if that's your thought, if that's what you're thinking, to truly look at the heart of Christianity. Truly look at how, even though some people might disagree on spiritual gifts, or the mode of baptism, or what election is and how that plays out, they are still willing to fellowship together because they believe in the same triune God. They're still willing to fellowship together because they believe that their sins are forgiven in Christ and in Christ alone. And from that, that's how we can truly identify who the universal church is. And so if you have any questions about that, I would really encourage you to research into that, look into that, and to see that these false teachings have differentiation from what we would consider Orthodox Christianity. Lastly, it's important for us to see that we are freed in Christ. Here, John is addressing the children, the young men. Look with me at verse 13 and 14. He says, I write to you, children, because you know the Father. And then he says, I write to you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the evil one. Okay, again, so this might seem a little bit confusing. The young men, they're the younger ones. They're the immature in faith. How is it they have overcome the world? How is it that they are strong? That wouldn't make sense. We wouldn't look at someone who's weak and say they're strong. So we need to kind of figure out what's going on here. Again, John does a great job of explaining that later in the letter. If you go to 1 John 4:4, he says, little children, you are from God and have overcome them. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. They overcome in Christ. It is through Christ they overcome. He reiterates this point in chapter 5. If you look at verses 3 and 4, he says, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Verse 5, he says, who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? So ultimately, it is in Christ these believers overcome the world, that these believers are freed from the power of sin. Jesus himself says something similarly in the Gospel of John, chapter 16, verse 33, when he says, I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. So Christ has overcome the world. And because of that, because of our faith in him, because of what he has done, that truth now applies to us. We have overcome the world as well. But how do we do this? You know, what does this look like? Well, specifically, again, go back to verse 14. He says, and the word of God abides in you. That's why they're strong, because the word of God abides in them. They have strength because they know the truth. They have strength because the word of God is stored up in their hearts. Psalm 119:11 says, I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. So it's imperative for them, and it's imperative for us to know the word and to know what we believe and how it plays out. And so a lot of what I'm talking about might seem like, okay, well, it's just knowledge. You're just saying, believe this, believe this, believe this. But there's also actions that we have to do to live out our salvation, to live out what we have been called to. And for some of you, you know, you might be like, okay, I want God to really change me in this area of my life. What do I do? Do I just pray? Or do I just work really hard? And I don't know if this has ever happened to you, but I feel like it's a pendulum that swings back and forth. So let's say you're like, okay, God, I really want to stop lying. So you just pray, you pray, you pray, you pray. Just God, help me stop lying. God, help me stop lying. God, help me stop lying. But you get to a point where you're like, all I'm doing is praying. I need to just work really, really hard. And then the pendulum swings the other way, and you completely forget about prayer. You're just like, I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to lie. But then you keep lying. You're like, well, I just need to pray some more. And so you just go back to the other side. And that's a Christian life. That's how we live the Christian life. We just keep going back and forth and back and forth. And maybe for 5 minutes on a day, we get it right. But the way that it plays out is more like this. So growing up, I did Taekwondo. Don't ask me to do anything. I don't know how to do anything now. So I did Taekwondo. I was elementary school. I was a weak guy. I'm still a weak guy now. I don't have the biggest build, but that's a different discussion. And so, you know, for these tests to get the next belt, you got to break these boards, okay? So me and my brother, love the guy, we're both weak. And so we're going, you know, everyone is in front of us. They're cracking the boards, whatever, and we're doing this. We probably spent half an hour. And, you know, I swear that board was made out of something else, but we're going at it. We're going at it. We're hitting it. Oh, my goodness, we're hitting it. And I'm just like, this is ridiculous. It's never going to happen. We're the last ones left. Everyone's waiting for us so they can, like, hand out the belts. And so eventually, you know, the instructor comes along, and, you know, he grabs my hand. He does the same thing with my brother. And, you know, he grabs my hand, and then he, like, I guess, I feel like there's some soft spot or something, but, yeah. So he grabs it, and then he, like, smacks it with my hand, and the board breaks. And so, you know, he didn't hit it. He didn't just say, okay, I'm going to break the board for you and then hand it to me. No, he took my hand, and he helped me to break the board. And in that sense, that's how the Christian life is to be lived out.
We get so caught up with, is it God, is it me? If you're a thinker, you might say, well, what is true? God's sovereignty or man's responsibility? And you can spend hours there. And the truth, and the answer to that is yes. It's both. They don't have to be contradictory. Just because we can't fathom something doesn't mean it's true. There's plenty of things we don't understand, but we still take them as true. We take them in faith. And so what does that mean for us? Well, it means that we actively live in the body of believers. It means that we actively are praying. We actively are seeking to put our sin to death. But we can't do that apart from God. Paul does a great job of explaining this in two places in Scripture. In 1 Corinthians 15:10, he says, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me." Again, you know, he said, I worked hard, but the grace of God was with me. Also, take a look at Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 13. He says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my absence, but much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. How? For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure." These things work together. We don't need to run to one side. It's not a let go, let God. It's not just pray, let go, let God, everything's going to be okay. No, there's effort in the Christian life. But this effort is driven by grace. This effort, we get strength from it from the Holy Spirit. He is the one who empowers us to live in those ways. And ultimately, we're reminded of these truths over and over and over in God's word, in prayer, and when we fellowship with one another, when we encourage each other. That's why the Christian life is not an individual walk. That's why we don't go to just 100 churches. Everyone's at their own church and they do their own thing. No, we are one body. And we need to be confessing our sins to one another. We need to be asking each other to pray for us. We need to let others know when there's times we might be weak and tempted and say, hey, please check in on me. We need to tell others of, you know, I really struggle with anger. Can you keep hold me accountable to that? And I think the beauty of this is that there's equality. There's equality in the body of Christ. I think a lot of times maybe we've grown up where your parents are always right and the kids are always wrong. Because why? Well, because they're your parents and what they say goes. And I'm not saying to be rebellious. I'm not saying you don't listen to your parents. You're given commandment to honor your mother and father. But what would it look like if those of us who are perhaps older, either in age or old, maybe older, spiritually mature, what would it be like for us to rebuke, to receive correction from someone who's younger? Maybe from our kids. You know, that might seem very embarrassing. Oh my gosh, like I'm in sin. My kid is calling me out on it. But there's equity in the body of Christ. I remember hearing a pastor giving a sermon once and where he shared he was so convicted that he had treated his baby poorly in some way or another that he's like, you know, she's crying. She has no idea what's going on. And he's crying. He's like, please forgive me. Please forgive me. Please forgive me for the way that he treated her. And I think that's what we need to strive towards. So again, I'm not saying that you just disobey your parents. I'm not saying that kids are always right, because they're not. I mean, believe it or not, kids, sometimes you're wrong. And your parents are wise, and they have much life experience and age experience, and you can learn from that. But I think it would be a beautiful thing for someone to say, hey, Mom, you know, I feel like you got angry with me earlier. And instead of being so defensive and saying, no, like, no, you're wrong, but say, thank you for calling me out on my sin. I apologize, and, you know, will you forgive me? And when we see that happen, that is the body of Christ. That is what the world wants to see, because that doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. We live in an age where, you know, people who are older are always right. But if we get that, we'll live in a manner that is attractive to the world, and we'll live in a manner that shows that we truly believe the gospel. Maybe at the end of all of this, you're thinking to yourself, I don't see how God can forgive my sin. You know, I've done the same thing over and over and over. Like, how is he not tired of me? How has he not turned his back on me? The example I want us to think about is the reformer Martin Luther struggled with a lot of guilt, a lot of condemnation. He swore once that he saw the shadow of Satan, and he took an inkwell, which, you know, they wrote with I guess, ink and quill or whatever back then. He threw it at the wall because he thought Satan was there. And he's trying to hit him. That's not the way to live the Christian life. You know, we're not paranoid and saying, okay, well, you know, I just need to physically do stuff to attack Satan and all these lies that are coming towards me. But he came to a place where he realized that his righteousness was from God, that God had declared him righteous in Christ Jesus. And so those times that you are tempted to be condemned, those times that you are tempted to live in your sin and your shame, and those lies keep coming to you over and over and over, you respond and you say, yes, I'm a great sinner. I've sinned over and over and over again, but I am covered by the blood of Christ. And because of that, I am free. There is no condemnation, therefore, for those who are in Christ Jesus. And you take that and you run with it over and over and over. God is for you. God is for you. God is for you. And because he is for you, and because of what Christ has done, in Christ you are forgiven. In Christ you are fortified. And in Christ you are freed. Let us pray.